everyone to this special webinar on health security is central to sustainable societies. And is antimicrobial resistance a threat? This webinar is being jointly hosted by World Alliance Against Antibiotic Resistance, or WAR. Three A's, W, three A's and R. It's actually a war against antimicrobial resistance. So we are holding it jointly with WAR, AMR Times, and of course CNS. Before we begin, can we take a quick poll question just to wake all of us up? The poll question will be coming on your screen. And the question is, antimicrobial resistance develops when this disease-causing germ becomes resistant to drugs. You have six options and you can take only one, and you get 15 seconds to do so. So your time starts now. Come on, folks, wake up, be quick, have your say. This is an anonymous poll, so don't worry even if the answer is wrong, and basically nothing is right or wrong in black and white. So, okay, time is up, and the correct answer is, let's see how the poll went. Okay, 20% say when bacteria becomes resistant to drugs, virus 0%, fungus 0%, some parasites 0%, all of the above 80%, none of the above 0%. Oh, very well done. So basically, yes, it's all of the above. Antimicrobial resistance means the drug becomes resistant to, or rather the bacteria or the virus or the fungus or some parasites like the malaria parasite. Either any of them, if they become resistant to drugs, it is antimicrobial resistance. Okay, so let's move on now with our webinar. As we know that heads of states of over 190 countries who will attend the 73rd United Nations General Assembly in September 2018 will debate on the theme around sustainable societies. Global health security is inalienable to sustainable development, where, as it is said, no one is left behind. While the call for accelerating research and development for new diagnostics, treatments, and vaccines is rightly getting more attention, we are also losing on existing drugs that are no longer working effectively, with more and more disease-causing microorganisms becoming resistant to them. Antimicrobial resistance, or AMR, as we call it, is one of the biggest public health crises globally, as it is creating superbugs that are becoming untreatable and proving to be a bottleneck in eliminating diseases like tuberculosis, malaria, etc. Today's interactive session with key experts will help us understand what is AMR, how does it occur, and why is it of importance to stop it and ensure universal health coverage in order to achieve the Sustainable Development Goals, or SDGs. Just a few quick housekeeping announcements. I request the panelists to please take not more than 7 to 8 minutes each so that we have enough time left for the open question and answer session. I also request the participants to please sending their questions and comments even as panelists present, and not wait till the end. You can click on the Q&A box which you would be seeing on your screen and then type in your question. If you wish to speak, please click on the virtual hand you see on your screen once the open session begins. I now welcome our guest moderator for today, Ashok Ramsarup, who is a widely acclaimed award-winning journalist based in Durban, South Africa. He was a senior producer at South African Broadcasting Corporation. Over to you, Ashok.
Again, World Health Organization Director General, Dr. Tedros Adhanom Ghebreyesus calls antimicrobial resistance, AMR, a global health emergency that will seriously jeopardize progress in modern medicine in the 21st century. Antimicrobial resistance is poised to have devastating global consequences, making it impossible to treat previously curable diseases, including tuberculosis, malaria, gonorrhea, influenza, etc. AMR already contributes to an estimated 700,000 deaths a year globally, and the figure could rise to 10 million deaths a year and $100 trillion in lost global productivity by 2015 if nothing is done to stop it from spreading. The growing threat of AMR is also undermining efforts to eliminate TB by 2030, which is one of the 17 sustainable development goals. We have two new drugs, Bedequilin and Delamanid, to treat drug-resistant TB. South Africa is the first country in the world to incorporate Bedequilin in its national TB control program, making the drug part of its standard recommended treatment regimen for rifampicin-resistant TB, making latest drugs and treatment regimens accessible to all is indeed commendable, but it is equally important to protect them from becoming ineffective over a period of time. Well, let us now hear from more from the experts who are here with us today. Our panelists for today's interactive session are Dr. Soumya Swaminathan, Deputy Director General for Programs at the World Health Organization. She is the first Indian to hold WHO's second highest rank. A reputed clinical scientist, Dr. Swaminathan is a globally recognized researcher on tuberculosis and HIV. Dr. K.S. Sachdeva, Deputy Director General of Central TB Division, Ministry of Health and Family Welfare, Government of India. Dr. Sachdeva heads the National TB Control Program of India. Dr. Kamini Walia, Senior Scientist, Division of Epidemiology and Communicable Diseases at the Indian Council of Medical Research, ICMR. Dr. Walia is currently leading the setting up of antimicrobial surveillance network of ICMR and is coordinating activities of the antimicrobial stewardship program for India. And not forgetting Dr. Tim France, Managing Director of Innes Communication and noted thought leader on global health security and sustainable development. He's also led the development of a very unique search engine that promotes lateral thinking in this era of multi-sectoral collaboration, www.sdginsights.org. I now hand over the mic to Ms. Shobha Shukla, Managing Editor of CNS.
Thank you, Ashok. Our first panelist for today is Dr. Soumya Swaminathan, who will elaborate on the broader AMR issues that are threatening global health security.
Thank you very much, Shobha, for this opportunity and for highlighting this important topic, which really affects all of us, both in the TB field, but also more generally. And you've already mentioned the huge burden of AMR currently, and you know the number of deaths it causes, starting from newborns dying of antibiotic resistant infections to people infected with TB and MDR-TB and so on. It's good that there's been a lot of global attention, and as you know that the UN Secretary General even set up a high level committee to an interagency coordination group to look at AMR, and this report will be submitted back to the UN Secretary General in May 2019. WHO hosts the Secretariat and we are part of the tripartite, the WHO, the FAO, the Food and Agriculture Organization, and the OIE, which is International Organization for Animals, working together along with a number of independent experts and member states to really look at what can be done very holistically in the area of AMR. WHO has something called GLASS, which is a surveillance system for antibiotic resistance. And last year, the report had data from 22 countries. I'm happy to say this year, I think we will have more than 50 countries that are providing data. And this will sort of form a baseline and help us to track progress. As far as the interventions are concerned, I think we need to act on several fronts simultaneously. One very important element is the use of an implementation of infection prevention and control in healthcare settings, starting from primary healthcare settings to tertiary hospitals, having guidelines for the use of antibiotics so that all healthcare workers follow standard guidelines, whether they are in the private sector or in the public sector, and reserve the use of the latest antibiotics for where it's really needed. Veterinary and agricultural use of antibiotics really needs to be stopped in terms of using them as growth promoters or even for prevention of disease, and use them only for treatment where it's needed. And also to reserve the use of certain antibiotics. You know that WHO has a classification of antibiotics in three categories. And the last category are the ones that need to be kept in reserve. It's called the AWARE classification of antibiotics. So the ones that are in the reserve category should really not be used for animal use, to be reserved for humans. And lastly, the environmental aspects, which is really the production facilities and the disposal of antibiotics so that they're not contaminating our water and soil and so on, and spreading the resistance mutations to bacteria which are in the environment. Now, just a couple of words on TB and drug resistance in TB, of course, is something that has been monitored for much well before AMR really became of global importance. And so we have data going back to the 70s and 80s. It's very clear that in TB, the drug resistance is of two kinds. One is primary, which if I get TB from somebody who has drug resistant TB, I get those bacteria and get infected. That's primary drug resistance. That's increasing. And secondary drug resistance or acquired is when I'm a patient with TB and I'm on the wrong combination of drugs, or if I'm not taking the right doses or I'm irregular, then I develop resistance. I start with sensitive bacteria and then I go on and develop resistance. So this is now being addressed through WHO actually making guidelines and saying that everyone who has suspected TB must get a molecular diagnostic test or a test for drug resistance right from the beginning, so that the person, the patient, gets the right combination of drugs. And secondly, now that we have two new drugs, Radaquilin and Dalaminid, that have been developed in the last few years, we have come out with the guidelines very recently. There's a rapid communication that's been put out about the use of these new drugs. But I think what's also very important to say is that not only should patients have the right diagnosis made and appropriate treatment given, but there need to be support for that patient to stay on treatment. We know that treatment for TB is long, and treatment for drug-resistant TB is even longer, can be anything from 18 to 24 months. And so patient support, counseling, peer support, and if they need nutrition and other kinds of social support, are absolutely critical to ensure that we do not go on amplifying this development of drug resistance.
Thank you. Now, as we need for new drugs and TB, say we are talking of tuberculosis, need for new antibiotics, and we have the two new drugs, Bedaquiline and Dalaminid, do you think we need to have very special safeguards to be put in place for the cautious use of these new drugs and new antibiotics so that the bacteria does not become resistant to them after some time? Is that fear there? And are there enough safeguards in place, particularly with special reference to these two drugs in TB? As you said, WHO has put safeguards in place, and how do we ensure that at the country level they are being met just to prevent that resistance going to the new drugs as well?
Yes, I think after 40 years, you know, we've seen a new drug for TB. So hopefully in the future we will have more drugs developed. But I think it's very important to use the drugs we have wisely and to preserve their efficacy for as long as possible. TB bacteria are capable of developing mutations, just like other bacteria, if they are exposed to the drugs in the wrong dose or for insufficient time. And so it's really important to use them properly, the correct dosage and the correct time duration for which they need to be given. The guidelines that have been put out by WHO are very clear about the use of these drugs, and also they have to be used with the right companion drugs. So TB is one organism which can never be treated with a single drug or even with two drugs. You need a combination of 3 to 4 highly effective drugs. And that's why it's so important to know the resistance profile of the bacteria before starting treatment. While on the one hand, we need to safeguard these drugs to make sure that they are effective at least for the next couple of decades. At the same time, it should not be so restrictive that people who need them are not getting them. So we have to strike the right balance and make this drug accessible to every patient who needs it now. And that's why the new guidelines today really talk about replacing injectable with bedaquiline, because we know that a lot of patients become deaf because of the use of injectables for prolonged periods. So again, I want to emphasize that the patient-centered care is very important. While it is a public health program and we need a public health approach, every patient is important. And within the public health program, we need to ensure that we are able to stay with every patient, to track them, to monitor them, to make sure that they complete the full course of treatment and without developing, you know, too many side effects. And if we're able to do that, then we can really protect these drugs for a long time to come.
Thank you very much, Dr. Swaminathan, for really explaining why it is urgently important to control antimicrobial resistance, not only for tuberculosis, which is important, but for other diseases as well. Our next speaker is Dr. Sachdeva. We are waiting to hear Dr. Sachdeva.
Thank you, Shobha, and very good day to all of you.
Dr., bedaquiline and delaminate are the two new wonder drugs in the treatment of drug-resistant tuberculosis. Can you please elaborate a little bit on them? What are the criteria for giving these drugs to patients of TB?
So bedaquiline and delaminate have come on the horizon of TB control nearly after 4 to 5 decades of the last new TB drug being available on the market. And they hold a great potential to improve cure in TB patients, especially in drug-resistant TB patients. Within our program, the drug-resistant TB patients who are intolerant to the conventional drugs, or who have an additional drug resistance, so say an injectable or an oral drug called a quinolone, they are offered treatment with these delaminate, stroke, bedaquiline. And the interim analysis, we have yet not started with the introduction of delaminate, though the preparations are complete, but the interim analysis with the use of bedaquiline shows very, very good promise in drug-resistant TB patients.
What is the current status of bedaquiline use in India? Are you using on a pilot project or in few states, or just if you could update us?
So initially, bedaquiline was approved under the program about 3 years ago on a pilot project basis. We also negotiated at that time about 10,600 courses of bedaquiline to be made available to the country. But subsequently, with the when we completed the training of our providers, when we started implementing on a few select sites, we had the confidence that we could roll out in the entire country, and now we are implementing the bedaquiline usage in identified drug-resistant TB patients throughout the country, in all the states of the country, so that bedaquiline treatment is being offered. So we have almost 1,800 patients are ongoing on treatment. Now the enrollments are picking up, and we are quite hopeful that we'll be able to scale it up in a more holistic manner to all those who need these kind of drugs.
Okay, now like South Africa has recently announced inclusion of bedaquiline in its national TB control program. Do you think it's feasible and appropriate to include bedaquiline-based treatment regimen in India?
Bedaquiline-based treatment regimen is already there in our country. We have already scaled it up nationally. The issue remains at what point in the patient's journey towards the TB cure we are introducing those drugs in the country. So while South Africa may have introduced it upfront for all drug-resistant TB patients, we are still introducing it in the patients who do not tolerate the conventional drug resistance or who have some additional drug resistance to other drugs. However, we are also inclined to scale it up, and we are going all ahead to scale it up as we have more and more experience with the use of drugs, and people in the periphery are comfortable using these drugs, because this, along with the usage of drugs, you also have to make them comfortable in the use of drugs. They also have to be very vigilant with the side effects. You need to have certain basic bare minimum investigations available within your setup, then only the bedaquiline can be introduced. So short of that, it is inadvisable actually to go to the most peripheral level. But having said that, we have actually moved to almost all the districts in the country which are implementing TB program or also rolling out bedaquiline in our country.
What safeguards do you think need to be put in place to ensure appropriate use of the new drugs so that the TB bacteria does not become resistant to them? Because right now we are seeing a surge up in antimicrobial resistance. So I think we need to be very careful, particularly in high TB burden countries like India. What are the safeguards which are there?
This was one of the concerns when we were introducing bedaquiline in the country, and that's where I think the country was very firm in saying that we will allow use of bedaquiline only conditionally, and we called it conditional access program. The meaning thereby, the drug could only be introduced through the public sector and when you have certain bare minimum criteria met for the introduction of drugs. So you have to have the entry criteria into the usage of bedaquiline. You also have to rule out certain preconditions before you become eligible to get that drug. So ruling out is also as important as the entry criteria, so that patient does not suffer unnecessarily because of side effects or other effects. At the same time, a strict entry criteria and a conditional access only through national program, so that there is no misuse of the drugs. So because if we lose this drug, which is now available after 50 years, I don't think then we have another chance to control TB in the country. So this is with bedaquiline, but the same safeguards are now being observed with other drugs. So similarly, we are promoting rational use of drugs. We are promoting it with the industry, academia, all our program managers, other stakeholders on how the drug should be used rationally and in a systematic manner following the duly approved national algorithm for introduction of drugs in the country, both for the public sector as well as the private sector.
And for this, doing upfront drug susceptibility test is...
So that's the national policy now. We are, all those who are diagnosed as TB are offered an upfront drug susceptibility testing. So that's a national policy, and I think close to about 7-8 lakh patients last year received that upfront drug susceptibility testing, and we are confident we'll be achieving almost 100% targets in this year or maximum by the first half of the next year. So national policy, we are now focusing on how to implement it holistically so that everybody gets that upfront drug accessibility testing. The infrastructure is available, the testing facilities are available, the test cartridges are available.
Thank you, Dr. Sachdeva, especially for emphasizing upon the rational use of drugs, also the new drugs. I would now request Dr. Kamini Walia to please tell us about the Antimicrobial Stewardship Program of India. Dr. Walia, how is the Antimicrobial Surveillance Network going to help us deal with the growing threat of AMR?
Thank you for inviting me to this webinar. Are you able to hear me?
Yes, very clearly.
Thank you. So, ICMR is a research organization under the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare. I can actually go without the slides. You may not project the slides. Because okay. Slides are too...
That's very cool.
Yeah.
Yes.
So ICMR started its antimicrobial resistance initiative in 2012. And at that point in time, there was no countrywide data which was available for the AMR from our country, which could give us nationally representative data and the estimates on drug resistance. There were many labs which were working on AMR and gathering data on the drug resistance trends and patterns, but the methodology which each of the lab was following was different, and hence we could not draw a national inference out of it. So it was with this in mind that ICMR started the AMR surveillance network, and the first thing that we did was that we created standard operating procedures for bacteriology and mycology, and the entire network follows that. So the surveillance network focuses on six pathogenic groups, that is Enterobacteriaceae, gram-negative non-fermenters, gram-positives including Enterococcus and MRSA, typhoid-causing organisms, diarrheal diseases-causing organisms, and fungal pathogens. The reason that ICMR's network focuses on these pathogenic groups is that there's no other national program which is looking at these infections, drug-resistant infections caused by these bugs, which cause large number of drug-resistant infections in our hospitals as well as in the communities, and there was no nationwide data which was available. So what we are now doing is that we have 20 hospitals in our network, which is a good mix of both government as well as the private hospitals. We gather data from these hospitals, and we are using this data to guide treatment interventions, treatment policies in these hospitals. ICMR brought out hospital infection control program policy as well as the treatment guideline, which is based on the ICMR data. And now we are now that the surveillance network has been going on for last 4 years, we are now moving to the next phase of the surveillance, which will focus on looking at the mechanisms of resistance, the clonality, and the transmission dynamics, as well as working with all the hospitals which are part of ICMR network to improve the diagnostic stewardship as well as the infection prevention stewardship and the antimicrobial stewardship. So it is the initiative which is going on at multiple levels, because we do understand that unless we reduce the number of infections in our hospitals, we will not be able to achieve much on the antimicrobial resistance reduction, because this is the large denominator of drug-resistant infections in hospitals, which actually give rise to the drug-resistant infections. So this is what the line of thinking is. And the other thing is that we are working very closely with these hospitals on reducing the infection rates, which is being funded by CDC-funded project under the Global Health Security Agenda. We are also working to improve the One Health surveillance, which includes the animals as well as the environment, and working with both national partners, which includes the Indian Council of Agriculture Research, as well as the Food and Agriculture Organization of the UN. from the data that we have right now, we see that the antibiotic pressure is one of the major drivers of antimicrobial resistance in our setting, and overuse of antibiotics is something that we need to focus on and curtail. One of the most important finding of our network is that in the Salmonella typhi, we were seeing a lot of multi-drug resistant typhoid infections in the 90s, where the bug was resistant to three antibiotics, which is amoxicillin, cotrimoxazole, as well as and the chloramphenicol. But over a period of time, since the use of these three drugs declined, so we saw increasing sensitivity to all the three drugs in our healthcare settings as well as in the community settings. However, now we see increasing resistance to ciprofloxacin and increasing resistance to ceftriaxone because it is now being commonly used to treat these infections. So antibiotic pressure is actually driving the lot of drug resistance that we see in our hospitals. Also important is that most of the infections in hospitals are caused by gram-negative organisms, which are responsible for a major group of drug-resistant infections rather than gram-positives, which is mostly seen in the Western countries. So the most important ones are E. coli, Klebsiella, Acinetobacter, and Pseudomonas. These are the four pathogens which are of prime importance for our healthcare settings. Klebsiella pneumoniae, we are seeing increasing resistance to carbapenems over a period of time, which actually is very dangerous because the only drug which is left to treat these infections is colistin. And we are also seeing that carbapenem resistant Klebsiella pneumoniae cause a lot of deaths, and the case fatality rate in these patients is very high. Till a few years back, Acinetobacter and Pseudomonas were the key pathogens which were important from nosocomial perspective, but now Klebsiella causes the most drug resistant and the deadliest of the infections. Among the gram positives, we are seeing that MRSA has steadily decreased over the last 3 years, but at the same time, a lot of vancomycin, tigecycline, and linezolid, which is being commonly used to treat many infections without using the lower end antibiotics, is actually leading to increasing levels of MIC to vancomycin, linezolid, and tigecycline, and this actually is a cause of worry. Among the fungal infections, we are seeing very high resistance to fluconazole in Candida tropicalis as well as Candida albicans. Many hospitals are also reporting drug-resistant outbreaks of drug-resistant Candida auris strains, and ICMR last year actually published an advisory on how to prevent Candida auris outbreaks in your healthcare settings, and this is available on ICMR website. The antimicrobial stewardship program of ICMR was started about 4 years back, when we published one of the first guidelines, treatment guidelines, which was based on the Indian ICMR data. And also we brought out the infection control guideline. Both the documents are available on the ICMR website. And under the leadership of Dr. Soumya Swaminathan, we started engagement with the leaders of the healthcare institutions to allocate resources, both in terms of financial as well as the logistic resources, to initiate the antimicrobial stewardship program in the hospitals which are part of ICMR network. We also organized trainings on antimicrobial stewardship in the last year, and the hospitals which are part of ICMR network are now starting 1 year AMSP project, in which they will be creating treatment guidelines based on their data for their own hospital, introducing formulary restrictions or prescription feedback, one of these interventions in their hospital, look at the antimicrobial consumption in ICUs, and also doing some education and awareness activities around antimicrobial stewardship. So as you can see, the breadth of the initiatives is very wide, and we are working with multiple agencies and many hospitals from government and the private sector to kind of establish a model where we can say that if we have to bring about any change in the AMR patterns or trends that we see in our country, we have to have a multi-pronged approach, thereby meaning that we have to improve the diagnosis, we have to improve the infection control, infection prevention in our hospital, and at the same time, strengthen the antimicrobial stewardship program so that we can rationalize antibiotic prescriptions. So far we have had a few successes, but at the same time we feel there is a lot which needs to be done, and we will continue to strengthen the research in the area of surveillance, stewardship and infection prevention control in the years to come. Thank you
very much, Dr. Walia. Data indeed is important to inform policy. Moving on, as we all know, Sustainable Development Goals also envisage elimination of malaria by 2030, a disease which is endemic in many developing countries in Asia and Africa. We would like to hear from Dr. Tim France how AMR is threatening control of malaria.
Thank you, Shobha. I feel like the odd one out because I'm not talking about bacteria. So let me say a little bit about drug-resistant malaria and its impact on control and elimination. First of all, it's a kind of a story of good news and bad news, a very mixed story. We've had incredible progress over the past 15 years, as everybody knows, with something like 7 million malaria-related deaths averted and about 40% reduction in malaria globally. But we're currently at a tipping point, according to WHO. You know, progress is definitely slowing in some parts of the world and even reversing in a few. And we see the emergence of drug-resistant malaria in the greater Mekong sub-region. This is primarily resistance to artemisinin and partner drugs, and it's in five countries: Cambodia, Laos, Myanmar, Thailand and Vietnam. And with artemisinin, we're really talking about the frontline drug to treat the disease. And we don't see a kind of an overnight resistance, but a gradual slowing in the response to malaria infections is taking longer and longer to respond to treatment. So why is this important? I mean, this region of the world has long been kind of the epicenter of anti-malarial drug resistance. And so there are fears that history is repeating itself. You know, 40, 45 years ago, we saw chloroquine resistant malaria spread throughout the world from exactly this part of the world. And so there are a lot of fears about the risk of resurgence of malaria because of drug resistance and losing that progress that I just talked about over the past 15 years, either regionally and seeing setbacks regionally where drug resistance is actually occurring, or globally if that was to spread. Now, the data, I think the best we can say is inconclusive as to whether or not resistance is happening de novo, or new resistance, pockets of resistance are appearing, or whether spread is a real risk. And at present, you could say largely that there's more that we don't understand about malaria drug resistance than we do know. I think we're in a very active learning period. But at the end of the day, whether drug resistance is spreading or occurring de novo, the conclusions and essential actions are the same. So globally, malaria control and moving towards elimination, that's the two streams, if you like, of malaria programs globally, is continuing. The vast majority of malaria and malaria-related deaths occur in sub-Saharan Africa. And so from a public health perspective, it's only right that we should focus the malaria response on where those deaths are occurring. Malaria, at the end of the day, is preventable and treatable, and so nobody should be dying of malaria. And yet each year we see something like 200 million cases of malaria and around 500,000 deaths. So going back to the resistance regionally within the greater Mekong sub-region, there is a general agreement that the only way to tackle drug-resistant malaria is to get rid of malaria itself, to eliminate the disease, particularly where resistance occurs, so get rid of it completely. And this is really where we've got some of the good news. 23 Asia-Pacific heads of government have agreed and committed to elimination of malaria in the Asia-Pacific region by 2030, in line with the Sustainable Development Goals. And that's really, that plan is really about intensifying the endgame country by country and narrowing down the, you know, as the number of cases of malaria get lower, just concentrating in those areas where it's rolled back to. And there's also funding coming into the region for that kind of work. So just this year, the Global Fund have allocated something like, or announced the allocation of something like $240 million to support malaria elimination in the Greater Mekong sub-region. So there is a tension, but it's, you know, you've got to see that within the context of malaria responses globally. So I would say that drug-resistant malaria is not affecting the global responses that much, which focus on the countries where most of the malaria incidents and deaths occur. But what that does mean is that Asia will probably largely tackle drug-resistant malaria with kind of Asia-derived solutions and approaches and with Asian and national resources. So it's going to be kind of more tackled within the region. So how does this link? How does drug-resistant malaria link to this whole area of universal health coverage and health systems generally? Well, malaria, it's important to remember, malaria prevention, diagnosis and treatment take place at the health facility level, wherever you are. And the main reason that you know, 500,000 people, mostly children, die of malaria each year is not because malaria is not integrated into the health system, because it largely is, but because there are many people that health systems simply don't reach. And by the latest assessments, we know that about half of the world's population just don't have access to full coverage of the kind of essential services. And we know that drug-resistant malaria is occurring, or largely occurring, in very kind of remote forested areas in the Greater Mekong sub-region, where access to health systems is also very poor. So malaria is a good example of why we need to expand health systems rather than focus on a specific resistance challenge. And this is entirely consistent with the kind of renewed global focus on expanding universal health coverage and on primary health care. Health is complex, as we know, despite lots of progress in recent years with life expectancy and on specific. We know that the factors that affect and threaten people's health and well-being lie beyond their control, including things like inequity and access to healthcare, but also the impact of natural disasters and extreme climate events, as well as the many kind of social, economic, and commercial determinants to which people and communities are routinely exposed. So it's really addressing these realities that lies at the core of the health-related sustainable development goals, as well as the new kind of World Health Organization work plan, if you like, for 2019-23. Known as the Global Program of Work. So we're very very pleased to see this getting a lot more attention and profile. And at the heart of this WHO plan is a principle of 3 billions. So 3 billion people divided up according to, you know, a billion more people benefiting from universal health coverage and access to essential services, we're just saying, but then 1 billion people better protected from health emergencies, and another billion people enjoying better health and well-being, which might be through processes such as, you know, addressing determinants of health or health promotion approaches and things like that. So I think the important thing looking at these 3 billions is to emphasize, first of all, the difference between them. There is a lot of confusion, I think, that universal health coverage covers this whole gamut, but it's not. While the 3 billions do overlap, they're quite distinct from one another. And also asking, where did these 3 billions come from? If you think about the Sustainable Development Goal of universal health coverage being achieved between now and 2030, we're probably going to need something like 3 billion every 5 years, people being added to that. Until and to make sure we reach universal health coverage by by 2030. So I think that's probably where this idea of 3 billion every 5 years came from. So bringing this back to malaria, let me try and close this circle a bit. In many countries and local settings, take, for example, you know, the 11 countries that are responsible for 70% or so of the malaria in the world, the malaria is likely to be the largest or one of the most important components of those health systems and that primary healthcare structure. And because of the large number of malaria cases, that's why malaria is a big part of the health system. And in other places, like where drug resistance is emerging, you know, malaria has to be a big kind of focus of the health system in order to address that or to push the health system out to the places that it doesn't currently reach where resistance is taking place. So I'm kind of mentioning this because I'm very enthusiastic personally. I'm enthusiastic about the way WHO appears to have translated all of these global frameworks, like the Sustainable Development Goals, the focus on universal health coverage and primary health care, into this global program of work. In the past, WHO's work plan has been largely invisible, in my experience, but now it's something all organizations are being asked to be part of and invest energy in. And we kind of ask WHO to prioritize, and they clearly have. So in a sense, kind of one of the most exciting parts about this is that while the WHO Global Program of Work is a program, a work plan for an organization, it can also serve as a kind of a strategic framework for the entire global health community. And I actually think that's what's happening. So I've kind of touched on some of the ways in which the plan is aligned to malaria priorities and emergence of drug resistant malaria and those related priorities actions. But I do see similar touch points with other health issues such as TB we've been talking about so far, as well as non-communicable diseases. So it's really, I think, reflects the broad applicability of this. And I'll be pleased to answer or try to answer any questions that might follow. So let me leave it there for now.
Thank you very much, Tim. And you've so well connected AMR issues with universal health coverage and with what WHO is planning to do. We now open the question and answer session and invite participants for their comments and questions. You can click on the Q&A box, which you must be seeing on your screen, and then type your question. We have already many questions pouring in. We have a comment from Ekwi Ajide, senior editor at Anambra Broadcasting Services, Nigeria. Ekwi says there is a dire need for sensitization as many communities in the southeast region of Nigeria even today choose to patronize prayer houses for the treatment of TB instead of the hospital. Will any panelists like to say something to that regarding the myths that are still prevalent? Dr. Walia, would you like to comment?
Yeah, I think this actually highlights the need for a larger education around and a kind of a campaign for education and awareness creation among the communities. I would just like to bring one issue here that, you know, if you look at what kind of a civil societies or NGOs are working in this area, you wouldn't find many. Especially with, there are, in TB there are many, but they are not really addressing the antimicrobial resistance component, the drug resistance component of the disease. And similarly for malaria also, and, you know, the pathogens that I work with. So I think there is need for a larger, you know, at a global level, we should pitch for an awareness and the education campaign around giving the right treatment at the right time and the right diagnosis.
Thank you. There is another question from Moifo Porcia, a community health worker from TB Proof, South Africa. Moifo wants to know, if generic medicines are as good as the original medicines. So, Tim, would you like to comment on that?
Yes, I think there are good and bad generic medicines, just as there are good and bad original medicines. And I think the in malaria in particular, one of the issues we face is the quality of medicines in general. So I wouldn't draw the distinction between generics and originals. I would say we really need to do something about whether you call them counterfeit, fake, or low kind of bioequivalence drugs. This is linked also to the previous question, because I think the entry point for all of this is really kind of health literacy and literacy generally among people and communities, which is why engagement is so important. If people know what they understand more about what they're taking or why and where they should be getting their drugs, then I think controlling quality of medications would be much easier. But generally, there is no problem with generic drugs for many.
Okay. Okay. Thank you. Now we have many questions about irrational sale of antibiotics. We have a question from Anish Srivastava. A legal expert from India. He says, how can we cope against consumption of adulterated drugs and consumption of non-prescriptive drugs given by medical practitioners? In India, we still have many doctors who do not write a prescription, but just hand over the drug, the pills to the patient. A similar question from Peter Obiti from Kenya. Peter says, how do we regulate counterfeit drugs and purchases done without prescription? Dr. Ajay Kumar, district TB officer from Haridwar, India, says, why is there no ban on over-the-counter sale of antibiotics, including injectables, without any prescription? It is also not uncommon for even quacks and practitioners of alternate medicines to prescribe allopathic drugs. We have another question, similar question from Jens Seberg, saying that in India and in a number of other countries, antibiotics, including TB drugs, are widely available in the private sector, even without prescription, thus fueling AMR due to wrong use. What are the strategies needed to address these problems? I'm sure both Dr. Kamini, can you answer that?
We are aware of these challenges as they exist in our healthcare system. At one point, the government of India did think about making antibiotics as a prescription drug. I mean, will not be available without doctor's prescription. But then we also have to care for our communities where there are no doctors which are available who can write prescriptions. In that case, if we make it a prescription drug, then we kind of exclude those people and, you know, they might suffer. This was the thought process behind not making all the antibiotics as prescription drugs. Now, saying that, I would like to bring up changes which have been brought in by the regulator. One is that Schedule H1 has been introduced, which in which all the there are about 28 antibiotics which are third generation and above, second and third generation and above antibiotics, which have been introduced under Schedule H1, so that the pharmacist has to maintain record of where and to whom did he sell those antibiotics. So some of the beginning has been made, and in the recent in last 4 days, there was a judgment which came out where Government of India has banned the fixed dose combinations. Almost 328 fixed dose combinations have been banned, and large number of antibiotic combinations which were floating in the market and which made no sense, that have also been banned. So all this requires a regulator, strong regulatory restrictions in our country, but keeping in view the kind of healthcare infrastructure we have and the dearth of doctors in certain places, the system is just being mindful so that, you know, we are not being very, exclusive when we bring out these kind of rules. So there is a lot of thought process going around this, and I'm sure slowly, the regulators are going to not just improve the sale of antibiotics, but also how to implement all the rules that, we have come up with in the recent past.
Thank you. Tim, there is a question for you from Garance Upham of WAR. Garance says, it seems to me that drug resistance would occur more in people with some access to health services. The danger of blood-borne malaria contamination in hospitals with poor hygiene is hardly ever mentioned. I remember a doctor telling me of a patient in Pakistan with a knee surgery catching malaria in the hospital via blood transfusion. Tim, would you like to say something?
Yeah, I don't think much really is known about nosocomial transmission of malaria, but hopefully the vast majority of malaria that is could be transmitted through, whether it's transfusions or accidental transmission, would be treatable anyway. So, and in a sense, it's true that people who have access to the health system, or at least access to medications, if you believe the idea that resistance comes from kind of incomplete treatment and things like that. Well, I think the parallels between, ideas about and sometimes kind of patients being blamed for not completing courses of drugs are very different for antibiotics, which are much longer treatment regimes generally. So I think there's very little known about nosocomial transmission of malaria, but I don't think we should necessarily worry that that's going to lead to drug resistance per se. Just to also go back, to that question about what do you do about the sale and things like that and non-prescription drugs. I think there's a general shift to prioritize all of those regulatory mechanisms now. In some ways, it's linked to the introduction of new health technologies, such as the bedaquiline and delaminid that other presenters have been speaking about. But right from kind of approval, the approval stage where these things are approved nationally, right through pharmacovigilance and sale prescriptions and so on, and even linked to kind of surveillance and reporting, we've thought about regulation. Very much in terms of whether things are patented or not patented and whether they're on the essential drugs list and things like that. But what we find is when we try to introduce a new drug, many countries just don't have these regulatory mechanisms in place. And I think there's a race now to put those in place, which I think will help. We've done things in malaria like banning the use of monotherapies in some countries, but there's much, much more to do.
Okay. We have a comment from Amiti Verma from India. Amiti says, this is to address to all the panelists. Thank you for sharing your expert inputs and making this very important topic very accessible to me. Before today, I had no knowledge, not much knowledge about this topic, but I have come out much wiser after listening to the webinar. So a pat on all the panelists' backs. We have a question by Dr. Vineet Kumar Pathak from All India Institute of Medical Sciences. He is concerned that are there any checkpoints and guidelines for medical officers, especially those at primary health center level, to prevent AMR, as they are the ones who are treating many community-acquired infections? Dr. Walia, if Dr. Kamini, if she's there, or... Tim, would you like to say something on that? That will be probably our last question because we are now running out of time.
I'm just trying to unmute my microphone. Yes. Yeah, I know more in relation to malaria where those kind of guidelines are very detailed. We have, and I also know in the TB sector, there's a the handbook on closely managed and regularly updated. I mean, those are really good kind of reference points. Whether they get translated at kind of national level or down to the local level really depends, I think, on the national context. But the guidelines are there and are very, very frequently updated. I know, for example, the TB treatment guidelines have just been have been completely revamped just a few weeks ago. And they're done every 6 to 9 months and republished by WHO.
Okay. Garan has another comment to make. She says, in my experience globally, doctors are becoming aware of resistance and unfortunately tend to prescribe latest generation of AB instead of generic antibiotics, and this will decrease the lifespan of drugs. Tim, do you agree with that?
I think so. Yeah, I think I see it a lot. It depends on the context. I move between the UK and Thailand. I live in both places, and honestly, I'm surprised by the restrictions on antibiotic use that I see in the UK now. You know, I think there's much more awareness there, and you might think it would be the other way around, but there seems to be over prescription of antibiotics in middle income countries. That's just my personal experience. I haven't got any data for that, but it certainly seems that way.
Yes, I think you're right. In the UK, I think it's just the other way around. You just cannot get it, and in India, you can get all, right. And other countries also, you can get almost anything and everything over the counter, most of them. And it's not uncommon for people to take antibiotics to cure the common cold or the flu, because antibiotics is said to be the answer to all illnesses. And I think that is one of the reasons for fueling AMR.
And I think there is a lot more we could do about regulating that.
Yes. That's true. Okay. Thank you. We've already overshot the time. We come to the close of today's webinar. My sincere thanks to all our panelists for a very enriching discussion. We are grateful to the participants for their active engagement with the webinar. And last but not the least, special thanks to our guest moderator, Ashok Ramsarup. As always, the webinar link will be shared with you and will soon be available in the public domain. This webinar was jointly hosted by World Alliance Against Antibiotic Resistance, or WAR, AMR Times, and CNS. Our next webinar on 16th October at the same time, that is 1 p.m. Geneva time, will focus on climate change, agriculture, and AMR issues, and will be co-hosted by WAR and AMR Times and CNS with Dr. Helesis Getahun of UN Interagency Task Force on AMR, and an expert from WAR as panelists. So please do not forget the date. Till then, bye and have a good day.